and these will accommodate all the various different formats that different browsers take, because a lot of like Windows, they like the I think it's the EOT file. A lot of mobile devices prefer SVG. iOS originally liked SVG and nothing else, but now a lot of them, they tend to be fairly interchangeable now. But as many fonts formats as you can like specify and give to them, then as many different browsers you can cover. And then, just as you would before, when normally writing CSS, you can just say, oh, stick that Strangelove font and make that the first one in my font stack. And this is a really cool option because it gives you so much choice. Because there's all these really cool sites that have properly licensed fonts that are made for the web. So it's not just taking a dodgy free font, because they could be a bit rubbishy and render really badly. But there are some really nice fonts. Often they're paid, often they can be quite expensive, but they are worth it. And places like Fontsquirrel, they're really good because they're all free. So if you're looking for free fonts, Fontsquirrel is really good for embedding. FontSpring and MyFonts tend to be mostly paid fonts. They're the occasional free font, but they've got some really good quality stuff on there and really realistic packages, and you just pay a one-off payment, so a one-off license, and you can use those fonts on that site. They tend to restrict you to one domain at a time, but otherwise, one-off payment and you're done, and you've got that font, and it's really nice, it's really flexible and easy to use. And this has fairly high browser support on mobile devices, so you've got it on Opera Mobile, Android Mobile from version 4, iOS Safari, all that lot, BlackBerry even from version 5, but they only support SVG, so you've got to make sure that you have a font package that allows SVG. And obviously Opera Mini doesn't have, because that's not what Opera Mini does, it's all about small and quick. And Internet Explorer Mobile doesn't yet, I don't think. WebOS, that's a bit old, but it doesn't either. The downside is, though, that it can have a really high impact on performance. The problem is, you're loading another enormous file. It's like all these image problems with responsive design. You're trying to load more enormous files onto the screen. Often, they won't load at all. You'll get flashes of plain text and then fancy text and things like that. Or, yeah, not no text, and that's a bit rubbishy. But you can be smart and make fonts easier on performance when you're embedding them. So a few ways of doing this. One of the methods that I like is, particularly for mobile, just have fancy headers. Don't commit to a really nice font, really sexy font across everything. Because let's face it, you want to make the text as readable as possible. And having some sort of fancy, finicky font on your body text isn't going to make it any easier to read. So maybe just make the headers all pretty. Make those nice. That's not going to be loading too much. It's not going to take too much time. It should look quite good. And also, choose your glyphs with care. Choose the letters that you embed in the font with care. So if you look here, this is the font base kit generator on Fontsquirrel. And the really cool thing about this is you can take fonts you've got from elsewhere that you have the license for and add them in and create your own font base kit, and it'll spit out the relevant file formats and all the CSS that you need. It's really handy. And actually, if you go into their expert mode, you can actually choose the different elements of the font that you want to include, which means you can make that package a lot smaller, so you're not having to send so much to the browser. So it's things like choosing the character type you're going to use, choosing the language that you're going to use, and things like that. And then it'll show you all of the different glyphs that you've got on this one here. It's actually one long page, obviously a bit too long to load up here. And that way you can actually keep it a lot tighter. And there's also Unicode ranges, where you can really specify the exact characters that you want to include. So if you only want to use one fancy looking ampersand for one font, just in your logo or something like that, you could just specify that one character in Unicode, and that's all you need, and it won't take too much to load it up. And that is, actually, if you go to 24 Ways, that's something that Drew McLennan wrote about, and that's a really good article. Also, on fonts.com, they've written about the using the subsets for different languages to make sure that you're not excluding different alphabets and things like that, so that's quite handy one as well. And that was just saying that's Fontsquirrel on the page before. Our other option is adding fonts using hosted providers. And this is where it can get quite expensive, unless you're using Google Web Fonts. And I apologise for the really revolting colour. This is a bit mustard. But I was really worried that if the room was quite light, I had a nice yellow, and you wouldn't be able to read anything, so I went a bit mustard. But yeah, Google Web Fonts. So they're all free, and they're hosted by Google, so Google's taken all the load off that. But to be honest, the quality of a lot of the Google Web Fonts aren't that great. They're not actually the prettiest fonts in the world, they're not actually the most readable fonts in the world, they're just the free ones. And Google have collected a whole load of free fonts. So I probably wouldn't head there. I would go somewhere more like Typekit or FontDeck. They're really good if you want the really sexy fonts. If you want the really well made, really well considered, done by proper typographers, made for the web specifically, they render nicely across most browsers, they're what you go for. But you will pay for it. And they are generally subscription as well. So you'll pay a fair whack of money depending on what you're doing, depending on the size of your site, yearly. I think the Typekit, the portfolio kits, maybe about £50 a year, which is pretty good for like 10 small sites. That's not too bad. But it can get, if you're using a big site with loads of hits, that can get really expensive. And fonts.com is pretty good. They have subscription as well. If you want particular really well-known fonts, they've got a lot of those fonts that you've had on your computer for years, and they'll actually provide you the licenses to use them on the web, because you can't just use any font willy-nilly. And then the benefit of these hosted services are, they're very high-quality fonts, and they will look good. The downside is that they are often added using JavaScript. And obviously, mobile devices, JavaScript, not necessarily the best combination in the world. And they do work really hard to try and make this as quick as possible and as fast as possible, but you're going to really be supporting the most modern smartphones here. And even then, it could be laggy. There's often a flash of no text whatsoever, which is incredibly helpful for people on low bandwidth. They're going to get really pissed off with that. So that comes with a big warning. Can have huge effect on performance. But then again, like embedding fonts without font face, you can do the same kind of tweaks on a lot of these services. So you can specifically choose, so this is Typekit, if you're adding this font, you can choose the different weights and things like that you're going to use, exclude the weights you're not going to use, and that can make your kit smaller. And they show you how big everything is, and so you can roughly estimate how long it will take to load. And yeah, see the difference between loading all of the characters and the default, which is probably punctuation numbers and the standard Western alphabet, so not very much. There are a few technical issues to bear in mind generally. The mobile default system fonts are not the same as their desktop friends, so you can't expect there to be, there's Arial on every single desktop computer pretty much. That's a standard system font. But that's not the case on mobile devices. So if you look at Android, their default font is Droid Sans and Droid Serif and Droid Mono, I think. And they're actually really nice fonts. They work really well. They're designed specifically for small screens. But they're not Arial. So you've got to kind of get out of that webby mindset when you're thinking about these mobile devices. Another problem is that fonts can also render very inconsistently across different browsers. So if you've got a font that looks absolutely stunning on iPhone, it might look like a piece of crap on Android. So you never know, and you've got to test it. One of the old school techniques is just through progressive enhancement. So this is using a font stack to specify the fonts in order of priority. So say I've embedded through at font face the Strangelove font, which is some funky all caps font, I think. Probably not very good for a website. So you specify that first. And then, in case they don't have that, you then specify Arial. And then, in case they don't have that and they're on Android, then you specify Droid Sans. And then, if all fails, Sans Serif, because at least that's better than the Serif font and kind of gives the feel that I'm going for. And as I said, the trick is just testing the hell out of it. Just looking on as many different devices as possible, seeing how it looks, seeing how fast it loads. That's the best way to technically achieve what you want.
If you're on Android and you say Sans Serif, does it pick up? It doesn't pick up Droid Sans.
Does it not?
I don't know. I'm asking.
It should do.
Oh, okay. So you don't necessarily need to specify.
No, if you just on any browser, if you specify sans serif or serif, it will just give you the default right. one that it's got on the device.
Okay.
So it should, if you specify sans serif on Android, it should pick up Droid Sans. If you specify okay. serif, it should pick up Droid Serif.
Cool.
So how do you choose the best font for the job? First of all, we've really got to think about what do we actually aim to achieve through typography? What's the point of typography? And really, exists to represent content. That's what these websites are being made for. We're showing content, we're displaying content, we're just trying to find the most effective way to do it. And so here's the problem as a designer, is you want to make something pretty, but you want to make it usable. And this is a really great quote from The Elements of Typographic Style by Robert Bringhurst, which is a brilliant book if you want to get really into the meat of typography. It's quite hardcore. Typography must often draw attention to itself before it be read, yet in order to be read, it must relinquish the attention it has drawn. You don't want a font that's mega eye-catching and will distract you from actually being able to read it, but you still want something that's gently inviting. So, if you look here, that is some pretty scary-looking text. That doesn't scream read me. But then, if you look here at this Heinemann font, which is specifically designed for people with dyslexia and early reading and things like that, that's quite nice looking. It's soft, it's easy to read, everything's well spaced, it's very easy on the eye. It's good to have a typeface that reflects the meaning of your text. So here I've got, I've taken loads of chunks from His Dark Materials by Philip Pullman. And while it's a fairly modern fiction, it's on old themes. It's got lots of talk, sort of old world kind of stuff. And so I've gone for a serif font that kind of evokes a sort of old world feel. It feels like something you'd read in a book. And that's the idea that I wanted to bring across. And then we've got to remember that typography is used to try and convey order and structure. It's about showing how things are different from each other and how things are associated with each other. So here I've just got a chapter list. And you can see clearly through the use of the bold text and not bold text and then bold text again, you can separate out, well, that's the chapter number, that's the chapter title, and that's the page number. You don't just read it as 18 Frogonized 227. You don't think that's the chapter name. You realise that because these are all slightly different, that they're different items, they're different elements to read in a different way. Because this is a big old header at the top, you can tell that that's some sort of hierarchy going on. You can tell that that's more important because it's big and it's bold and it's up there. And so the idea is that we try and apply all of these different principles to make something that's just really inviting, really engaging to read. We want to lean in, we want to be enthusiastic and be like, oh, I really want to read this, but then we want to be able to sit back and just relax and actually read a lot of text at once. So think about what makes a typeface relevant. Because how do you choose what's the right thing for the content? And this is kind of part of that awkward context of each project's different. So each project you have different audience, you have different goals, you're trying to aim at different things. And that's quite tricky to tell. But then it's how that relates to the feature of the typeface. So what about the typeface might make it relevant to those goals, to those users? And I think one of the best ways to understand this is through a rough basic history of typography. So there are lots of different classifications of fonts. And I think that these are quite a good way of trying to understand what these different fonts are about. For example, humanist or old style fonts. Now this falls under, I think, fonts like Garamond and Minion Pro. These are properly old school fonts. These are early printing press. They're supposed to look like calligraphy. They're supposed to look like those monks leaning over. I mean, it's not quite black letter. It's not really high. It's the easy form. It's easy to read kind of text. You think about Bibles when you look at this kind of text. Then we have the transitional serif fonts. And these are like bars of your Times New Roman. Believe it or not, when these first came out, they were shocking because they were so high contrast and they had little sharp bits and fat bits in contrast with each other. Quite hard to consider Times New Roman being a shocking font nowadays. Modern serif. Now that's a font that they say modern, I kind of say it's more modern classic. So you'd associate this kind of font with magazine covers. If you look at Tatler and Vogue and things like that, all of their titles are going to be in a modern serif font. So this kind of fonts like Bodoni and Divo, they kind of convey a really high class feel. They feel very sophisticated. Egyptian or Slav serif fonts, I think they're quite friendly, but they're really bold. They're like marketing fonts. They shout at you, they're telling you what to do, but they've still got a kind of soft rounds to them in certain places. They still feel quite human. And so fonts like Adele and Rockwell, they're like this. They're boldy, advertising-y kind of fonts, but they feel comfortable. The humanist sans serif fonts, and these are like the humanist serif fonts. They're supposed to feel more friendly, more like natural writing, but they're much cleaner and much easier to read. They've got these kind of serifs, like elements to them. So the A, that's quite like a serif font, but they're very clean and they're very easy to read. Compared to the transitional sans serif, which are like the utility fonts. So fonts like Helvetica or Franklin Gothic, they lack personality. But that might be what you're going for. You might be going for a very Swiss, a very clinical feel, in which case that's what the transitional sans serif would be. I find the geometric sans serifs quite fun because it's very round. All of the letters are based on geometric shapes, so the O's are very round. If you look at an uppercase A, it's like a triangle. And this is in fonts like Futura and Century Gothic. They're very clean, very slick, but they feel very structural. And almost childlike because of how round all the shapes are. And then we have this huge family of script fonts. And you do have all the way to Comic Sans, the very comic book style. So it's kind of the idea of handwriting, but it's not really handwriting. You've got very formal scripts that are more like traditional calligraphy. And then there's this huge spectrum in between of things like marketing style scripts, all different hand-drawn kind of things. So they can vary hugely in between. They're generally not the best for body text. You don't want to read paragraphs in this. It's like have you ever tried to read anyone's handwritten letters lately? I mean, people don't really write them, but gosh, that's hard work. And you don't want to put people through that on the web. But they make nice fonts. They're nice fonts for logos. Occasionally a nice header. I mean, something like Edwardian script, that's going to be quite a nightmare to read a lot of. But stuff like, I think that one's marker pen. It's not quite Comic Sans. that's quite an acceptable alternative to Comic Sans, actually. I don't know why, it's just something about it that's just not Comic Sans, and that makes it nice. And then we have the horrors that are novelty or themed fonts. Very rarely appropriate because they lack any subtlety whatsoever. Papyrus. Look, I'm made of paper. Can't you tell by the little tears in me? I'm aged. It's really cheesy. And yeah, like this, like the a Dino sticker style font. That's not relinquishing itself in order to be read. That is just saying, here I am. Look at me. This is decoration. Not really design, but decoration. It might be nice for a poster, maybe, but probably not suitable for a website. Another thing we've got to think about when we're choosing our fonts is, are they overused? Are they already used in a lot of different places? So I have this problem with the font Lobster and Museo. They're free fonts. That's the first problem. If you choose a free font, chances are everyone else in the world has jumped on that free font before you because it's free and everyone's cheap. And it's quite hard to convince clients or bosses or whatever to shell out what's just a font. But the problem is that it kind of has given all the websites that use these fonts a particular feel now. Every time I see Lobster now, I think, yeah, you're cheap. And that actually extends to Marks & Spencer's, use it on some of their packaging. Marks & Spencer's? You won't have money to actually pay for a decent font. So you've got to be wary of where these fonts have been used before and that you're not being associated with something that you don't want to be associated with. But then it could work in your favour. So if you're designing an app or something like that, using Helvetica or Helvetica Neue. That's what iOS uses. So if you're using that in your iOS app, well then you're going to give across the same feel, that same native consistency. And so by proxy, you're almost going, well, they use that font and we use that font, so we've got the same sort of quality as Apple apps. And our app will work in the same way as the app, and you'll like it because you like Apple apps. And so that's actually maybe a positive thing to go with. There's another thing to think about when you're looking at the actual lettering itself. So you don't want something that's too heavy, because that's quite difficult to read. It's not a bad copy, it's just a bit tricky to read. Whereas in the same way, particularly on mobile devices and small screens and things that may not render very well, very thin fonts can be really difficult to read, and you can end up squinting at things like that because you just, because I mean, from where you are, you might find that a bit tricky. Probably should have moved that, it's not terribly easy to read, but the text isn't the interesting bit, it's the font. And then, I said before about thinking about which fonts you use for paragraph text. This font called Giddy Up, I mean, look how cute it is. It's got all these lovely little loops and little stars and things like that. It's really beautiful. But try and read that, and it's a nightmare. And the problem is that it's got all of these loops and things. They're tripping you up as you're trying to read. So when you're reading, you're skimming along words. You don't really read each word or letter individually. You're skipping along, and every time you're getting tripped up by all these little loops in the middle. So it's just not very practical. It's got too much detail in it. And then there's another problem that a lot of people forget to consider, and that's the counters on the letters. So that's the space. So if I've got a C, the space here, how open is that? Because if it's quite open like that, that's very readable. But if it's closed, like that, it's starting to look more and more like an O. So if you take my example, Rococo Cocoon. So it means A sound, that's fairly readable. I mean, it might trip you up because it's an unusual combination of letters. But if you try and read it in this font, Embryonic, hey, what's that look like? It's not easy to read. So you've really got to bear in mind that counters can make a difference if they're very close. And then there's a very controversial subject of what actually makes a type phrase beautiful. Because that has got to be subjective, hasn't it? Because everyone has different tastes. So, as Ellen Upton in the book Thinking with Type, which is a really nice introduction to typography, says, typography is a field governed by taste and convention. It's quite hard to separate the two a lot of the time, because a lot of people will go with the convention and think it's their taste, because that's what everybody else does. But I'll tell you what I think my taste is. And my taste, I think that fonts that are beautiful are always easy to read, because that's surely the most important thing. They have a good attention to detail. They consider how close the counters are, how open the counters are, and things like that. Yet they're subtle in their detail. They're not like that giddy up font with all the loops that are tripping you up all the way. They're keeping it nice and gentle and subtle. And they're well balanced, consistent and uniform. If you looked at them in a chunk of text, nothing jumps out at you, nothing stands out too much. They just sit there and they don't draw too much attention to themselves. So what I'm saying is, when you're considering these fonts, I think that you really need to listen to the fonts. I think that's a bit naff, but you've got to try and consider what they're saying to you. Just not the text, but the font itself. What is it saying to you? You've got to try and learn how to hear what they're saying. Identify, well, actually that font is a really humanist sans serif font, so that feels quite friendly to me, but that one's transitional. It's distinct. I mean, you don't need to know the different words for classifications, because actually, who cares about that kind of stuff? But you want to know how it makes you feel, what feelings that evokes, and what that font would make you appear to other people. And then learn to speak that language. Use what you can see is a good quality, another font, and learn how to use that to your advantage. So I say, go forth and use more fonts. That was me. So we got loads of time if anyone wants to ask any questions, we'll just hang out. I'm all good. Hey,
So given that most folks who, let's say, they're on your standard hand-sized mobile as opposed to a tablet, what would you recommend, given your 4 points or 5 points that you say makes a good font? Would you say that you should definitely think about this, considering you might be at a small pixel size, or people may be after the age of, let's say, 40, doing this farther out.
Yeah, I'd say go for reasonably large size fonts. A lot of people, especially in responsive design, they have this habit of, as the screen gets smaller, they make the text smaller as well, which makes it really hard to read. I never go below 14 pixels. It's very hard to compare fonts across pixel sizes, really, because some of them look really big at 14 pixels, some look really small. But 14 or 16 is small on a mobile device. But you've also got to be careful about, it's not just the font size that makes it readable, it's the line length. So if you've got too many words in a line, then that's going to be really hard to read because you're starting to read like this. Whereas if it's too short, it's going to be really hard to keep your flow because your eyes are constantly flicking back to the next line.
Yeah.
So it's kind of getting that balance between the font size and the line length that's what makes it the most readable.
And what would you give as a, let's say for example, if we were to follow some things that someone's, like Bruce Lassa said in his, so you're going to possibly be looking at responsive web breakpoints of 320, maybe 550.
Yeah.
What line length would you put if you're going to use a pixel ratio or if you were going to use EMs?
I don't particularly think in terms of the units, but I try to aim for roughly 10 words-ish per line, because that seems to be very... Lots of people have different preferences, and there are a lot of different schools of this is scientifically the best way to do it. But I find roughly 10 words per line tends to be quite readable, depending on the font and depending on the amount of text. Because if it's a really long passage, people might be okay with reading slightly narrower because they've got so much to read. But if it's actually a short amount of text, then people can be willing to read slightly longer lines because they're not going to stay with it for so long. I know that Ruth is putting her hand up, you're saying line height.
I was saying line height.
Yeah. Line height too it does have a big effect on the readability. I mean, it's the ratio between the line height and the font size is what really makes it more readable. You want to have quite a lot of nice roominess. I never put less than 1.5 ratio between my line height and my font size because I like to have big line heights because that does make it feel more open and easier to read. But it is down to the font.
So with those line heights, so with font face you can specify which fonts. So can you say if it's using Garamond, use 1.5, but if it falls back to something else, use a different line height?
You could do that kind of stuff with clever JavaScript, like polyfills and stuff like that, but CSS, there's just not much control over typography yet. There are all of these different proposed things that have been kicking about quite a while now, but there's not actually that much control over any of it yet. And there are some really good JavaScript plugins and things that do some really cool stuff. That you can even choose the code between individual letters if you're that OCD. But it's JavaScript, so it's going to be weighty on performance when you're already loading in fonts and things like that. So I tend to steer clear of it and just stick with the basic controls that we've got. Sorry?
I've had experience in using custom fonts on mobile have them taking quite well to load, so the text will pop up in Helvetica New and then suddenly change into some other font. Do you have any kind of tips for coping gracefully with kind of the latency of pulling in fonts?
One of the best things you've tried is making sure that your fallback fonts that you've got specified in CSS, make sure they're a similar, the same X height. I find that tends to minimise the shock value of having it suddenly change font. If they're about the same X height, they're not going to, the text isn't going to shift around too much when another font loads in. But other than that, I think there's not much you can do aside from trying to make the font load faster by reducing the amount of characters that you're delivering and things like that.
Cool. When you're doing design, do you tend to do the design and then choose a font, or do you find a font, or is it kind of itch how start with the font and then design a site around the font, or do you kind of design your layout and then find fonts?
Lay your idea font first, because I think that I tend to choose branding before anything, so I'll choose the colours and things like that, like the basic palette before I choose the rest of the design. And so a lot of the time I'll choose the font as part of that, because I think that that's a really important thing to hinge all the design on. Also, if you've got a really good font, I think it can lead to your designs being quite nice and minimal, because you're not trying to make up for it by making everything else look fancy. You're actually paying more attention to the text, which is probably a good thing. Yeah.
This
this has been fantastic. I'm a data geek, so this is all totally new to me, and you answered a ton of questions I've had in the back of my head for years about why people bother with this and why this is important and why certain websites give me a headache. So thank you, it's been brilliant. Can you tell me briefly how much work goes into building a font if you start from scratch?
Absolutely, I've done it because it's the most painstaking, people spend years making fonts, actual years. They'll hand draw them all beforehand, they'll switch it in and out and things like that, and then they've got to do every single different lift. Then the relations between the different lifts to each other and things like that, because you think about what happens when there's two Fs next to each other. Is there something special that maybe like a ligature that joins them to make it easier to read and things like that? So they've got all of those different zeros. And that's why fonts are so expensive, because someone's put so much of their time and effort in. They've got to pay mortgages and stuff too. And so that's why I don't begrudge paying the fonts for the money, because I can see how much effort goes into them, especially if they're also then going through and hinting them for wear and things like that, so they look good on screen and in print and stuff like that. It's mental. It's, yeah, like, before I've had fancies of, I'll do my own font one day, and then I actually look at the amount of attention to detail and hard work it requires, like, can't bother with that. Far too much effort.
This probably doesn't have any relevance to anybody else. I was wondering if you had a sort of list of fonts that were like Comic Sans. My mum works with kids with learning difficulties, and dyslexics, Comic Sans is one of the only fonts they can read because every single letter is different.
Yeah.
So however much we mock this, it does actually have a very good use practically.
There is one.
And it did look like your chalk one was very similar.
That's just an Apple default. I think that's marker bounce or something like that, yeah. I've been doing a project with kids recently, and I found this really good font called Heinemann, H-E-I-N-E-M-A-N-N, and that's on my fonts, and that's actually designed specifically for dyslexics.
Yes, I saw something, this was like a year or so ago.
It's not that one, it's
never
nicer.
Heard anything more about
I think
it
it's nicer
that.
Than that. It's actually visually nice as well as practical, mm-hmm. and that's why I like using it, because it feels soft and friendly and round and all those nice things without looking naff and Comic Sans-y, and is apparently highly readable. But it's difficult to judge those things when you're not dyslexic yourself.
It is really hard to judge.
Yeah.
That one.
No, that's not the one.
No, isn't it? Like all the ones are different on that one.
No, if you look on myfonts.com, they got it. It's not cheap. It's not expensive, but it's not the cheapest one in the world. But it is a really nice one.
Thank you. Oh, I also wanted to say to whoever it was that asked the question about jumpy fonts.
Yeah.
We had this problem like loads of years ago, and we were using Cypher and Kufon and all the awful ways of putting font into. And one of the workarounds we used to do was hide the font until that had loaded, and then sort of fade it in, so you didn't get a jump. You might have problems with that when you've got sort of in your default CSS it's display none, and you don't want that for accessibility because you kind of have to do the hack with JavaScript. But I was actually when she was saying that looking at sort of revisiting that and seeing if there's a better, more accessible way of doing it, because it is really annoying.
Yeah.
It is really annoying. Sorry.
Yeah, so I think the problem now as well is you've got all these really cool workaround stuff, and then you've got mobiles thrown into the mix, where everything is so much slower, people might be on rubbish bandwidth and things like that, and then suddenly polyfills and things like that go out the window a bit.
Yeah, exactly. I'm thinking, I don't know, I'll use it very well. We'll see if I will revisit it.
I've got a couple of fonts that I purchased for a comic book project that I'm doing, and I'm specifically going to try and do a web-based approach to a digital comic, but not like the way web comics are working at the moment. So I've purchased some specific fonts that I think work well for the story I'm trying to tell. But there's a weird licensing rule. You can't use them for web fonts.
Yeah. That's
and they're really strict if you read through the terms and conditions that they won't allow it to go on devices that get distributed. There's a difference between those fonts that you pay for, because that, as you say, they spend so much time trying to craft it specifically for that print medium. I think there's always going to be this fracture until the mediums can kind of conjoin and have some sort of working relationship with each other. Do you know anything within the industry that's changing in that area?
Part of the problem with that is actually that often by embedding fonts, you're giving them away. because if you're linking to them on your website, you're, in theory, people can go and get them, download them, use them themselves without the license, and that's the thing that they've got a problem with. They don't care about using print font on the web, because it might look a bit dodgy, but in the end, it's fine, it's just using a font, and they're not really that bothered about it, the usability of it. But I think that's where all of the subscription-based, the hosted services and things like that come in. They tend to host all of the fonts from the really fussy people that are really funny about piracy. I mean, it's like the music industry. It's like people are happy for Spotify to be used because they can get royalties and things like that through it, but they're not happy for people to pirate their stuff and allow it to be freely downloadable. And I think that at the moment that's going to be the only medium, is that they allow people to use subscriptions to access their fonts.
Could you, just thinking about it, could you create an SVG of like a balloon of text or a segment of text, something that could scale? Because ideally, you're delivering to devices that are going to be on X, A to Z densities and A to Z resolutions, so you never know whether it's going to be on an iPad with a Retina display or a 240 by.
But then you're back into the old school thing of using image replacement kind of techniques and things like that, and obviously Coupon and Cipher used to be good, but then things that rely on flash are no good. Got mobile devices and they're really very slow and rubbishy. Putting in images is fine, but accessibility, you've got to always provide all text and things like that. So it's, unfortunately, fonts are almost lost, I think. It's such a shame.
Have you looked at anything on the e-ink screen, just thinking like Kindle things, how that differs? Is that a whole other area, like you know, mobile screens?
Yeah.
So the kind of the slow refresh, but that kind of style of display that Kindles and ebook readers use, is there a different
kind of
thing?
But yeah, I imagine it's a whole different thing. Yeah, because the contrast is different. And
the refresh obviously is much slower, but that's not such an issue, I suppose, because of local.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's up for browsing and stuff as well.
Yeah.
From experience with e-ink, you do find that the serif ones look really weird because the screen resolution is low. It looks good enough for text, but when there's those little, are they serifs, the sort of traily bits at the end, they look a bit jaggedy. You can hack the Kindle and the Nook to put on like Droid Sans, which looks really nice. But
it's designed for a screen like that.
Yeah, so there is a difference. So, and I guess if you're going up to Retina displays, then if there's any imperfections in that font, it might be magnified. With a higher res screen.
That's the thing about Retina displays, the text can look really, really nice, but if it's a rubbish font, it looks horrible. Right?
Yeah, there are any properties of fonts that allow them to complement each other quite well, in particular. So, we often use two fonts on the site, one for the headings and one for the body text. So, is there any way we can match fonts together, or properties that mean they go together quite well?
I kind of cheat in that I often go for the same family of fonts. So a lot of the time, things like Droid Sans, Droid Serif, they're designed to be similar, they're based around the same shapes, so they'll work well together. And often I tend to pick typefaces that have massive families of different, like they've got bolds and black and medium and all these different weights, because then you can pick from these various weights and they'll have a completely different feel to them because it's a different weight. Or if it's italic, the italic's often completely different from the standard font, but it's got that similar feel to it, it's got the same shapes and things going on. And so I tend to just explore that same family as much as possible. And I think there's no silver bullet for how to pick a pair, but generally I go for things that have a similar shape to them, is sort of the best option.
Is there such a thing as a kind of visual explorer, which you get two blocks of text and it gives you random combinations of fonts, and then you pick the sort of things that you like, and then it gives you closer variations on that, so you can just feel your way? Because I've got a Typekit subscription, and pick one of 400 and then pick another one of 400, so you're straight away up to lots of combinations.
There are sites that do variations on those, and nothing was it together. So I know that there is a site that does font pairings. I can't remember the name of it. I'll look it up and I'll tweet it afterwards. Because is one that people will pick what they think are good pairings and put them up, which is quite handy, and it'll tell you where you can get them from. And there's another, I think there's a plugin, a browser plugin, that allows you to compare different fonts against on the same volume of text across different things. So that works quite well. There's a really good app called Typecast that's I think it's in beta at the moment, but that's got some really cool ways of comparing fonts and finding fonts from different services and things like that that can work well together and look great, and that's worth definitely worth checking out.
Do you sometimes serve different fonts to mobile, or do you have just one website? And
I haven't yet. I would consider it, because if I was going to use something really fancy, then I think for mobile you might need it out. But because if you're using it in CSX, then media queries is a really easy way of distinguishing between the small screens.
And the other thing I wanted to ask is, are there any serif fonts that would work for text on a mobile? Because I think it generally is probably...
Droid Serif is a good one, because it's because it's designed for that. In fact, if you look at all of the ISs seem to be putting a lot of effort into good mobile fonts as their default system fonts at the moment, so they're definitely worth exploring. But I know that the Droid ones are obviously there, open source, so you can use them anywhere. Georgia, I think, is pretty good, because that's a screen font too. Most fonts that are designed for screen tend to work fairly well. If they're first designed for screen rather than optimised for screen, they're generally really good on mobile, because it is a screen after all. Can we get them? Have a bit of time to get to the next one.